Terrell Blair of HLM Media. You know, we've been doing these weekly interviews, which have been a great success. We've been coming across a lot of great artists. And today we have the infamous. Talk to us.
Oh, what up? It's your boy Sean Conn. You already know what it is. One third of that mighty TriBoro.
You know, Sean, I come up. Well, I've heard your music, right? But it was at one of our shows we were able to get a chance to see you, you know, really do your thing lyrically, with the beat and without the beat. You dig? And that's the difference between us keeping in contact and understanding the art of what lyricism is. You know what I mean? Of being lyrical in a sense. You know, and I had a chance to really, you know, do sort of break down your history, man. You've been in the game for a little minute, man.
Definitely.
Give us a little history of how everything came about.
Well, you know, like a lot of people in New York City, just growing up, running home after school as a kid, and the first platform I ever saw about hip-hop that taught me hip-hop was Video Music Box.
Right,
know what I mean? So shout out to Uncle Ralph McDaniels, because that was the after-school special for real, you know what
I'm
saying?
Right.
That would teach us the culture, and from that point, you know, always been a fan of it. But then, it, you know, I would say 90s, middle 90s or whatever, the influences to actually want to rap and all that, just the thought of it, was actually Redman. The first artist, only because, like, for me, he influenced me by the reason that he was able to tell stories. He was definitely lyrical. He was respected streetwise. It wasn't like he was a clown or anything, even though he was also comical.
Of course.
So he had all the elements that I looked at as and said, you know what? That's dope, because that's like me. I have different personalities as far as who I am altogether.
Right.
To display that musically is dope. So that was a big influence, definitely, coming up. And then, you know, after that, just writing and creating. And there's a lot more to it. I mean,
Of course. So now in the process of now saying, you know what, this is what I want to do. You know, it's for a lot, they do it as a hobby. You did it as a profession, in a sense. You dig what I'm saying? Not to say that you didn't have a host of other streamlines of money's coming in. I'm talking about legitimately. But this is your profession. This is what you love. You don't like the fact that I want to do it today and tomorrow. I'm going to chill. I find that you've done it, man. You dig what I'm saying? Even in the fact of being in a group, how was that process?
Oh, that's wonderful, especially when you already started your path as a solo artist and had experiences, and then to be into a group where it wasn't even planned.
Right. Tell us about it.
Yeah, so the whole thing was, it was actually 2005, and I had did a project. You know, I was doing, like, you know, freestyle. I did a mixtape in 2002, going into 3, my first mixtape, The Last Colony Presents Sean Conn. You know,
right.
I could check that out.
Yeah.
That was a little classic. Did live numbers in the streets, hand-to-hand.
Way back, right, you know, of course.
Wasn't even on a mixtape level like that. I think around the time 50 kind of jumped off with that. And so anyway, a few years later, 2 years later in 05, I met a producer named Rich Moore from Canada. And he was also in the movie Juice. He was one of the dudes that was beating up Tupac with tracks.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
I was like, oh, that's crazy. When he showed me, I was like, that's crazy. But he had some real dope music. But he was also somebody that kind of told me, instead of just having raw rhymes and writing rhymes, song structure. That's very important as an artist, you know what I mean? So we did a project just for the love of hip hop. Didn't put it out. Only made 100 copies to give to a couple friends.
Right.
It was called The One. And it had 10 songs on it, all produced by him. And, you know, some are saying it's a secret classic in itself back then. So I got into the hands of somebody at Baruch College. They contacted me on the information side and called me for a radio interview. And while I was getting interviewed, somebody called up and was like, yo, you really dope, man. I would love to work with you or whatever, do a song with you. You know, I love your lyrics. So happened to be a Loose, aka the Conn Genius now.
Right.
That's him. You know what I'm saying? And he called up the station. I think he was trying to listen for his song, but happened to hear me and was like, yo, you dope. And his manager actually worked at the station. So they hooked it up. They sent me a beat a week later. I went to his crib and did a song called The BX to QU. And it's funny because shout out to Hip Hop Chef DR, my cousin actually. I went to his crib and him and Fresh Air are like brothers. You know what I mean? So I met Fresh maybe a couple months before that. And I played the song. It was like, it was dope. I said, yo, he engineered it, recorded, rapped. You know what I'm saying? I was impressed because
engineering
it and I didn't really see
that. Good package, right.
Exactly. And for an artist, and he had bars. So I was like, yeah, that was crazy. So I said, we got to go back over there. So I brought them over there. And they all like, yo, you have to do freestyle together. And we did it to 1-800 Hustler, the Rockefeller joint.
Right.
And from that moment on, he was just like, yo, y'all need to be a group. 10 years later, here we are after all the history of what we've done. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
World
right.
record breakers, performed on the White House lawn, the commercial for Obama, you know, so many things, multi-award winning, you know, we have a legacy within itself.
So let's rewind this, you know, so you were part of an era where a lot of promotion was grassroots.
Definitely.
How do you feel about then and now? I mean, why, I'm asking that because, you know, a lot of us, and I'm not just saying you, but a lot of us got a little comfortable with the fact that we can sit down on our computers or we can get on our phone and literally promo, right? Everything from our phones or our computer, as opposed to being out and about. You see how you said strategically, you put out 100 joints, but you was out and about doing that. Where do you stand with that? Because you kind of seasoned in a sense.
Well, the way I look at it now, and you know, the best way to look at it is what actually is missing now, because it's so tangible and easy to get to people through social media and things of those platforms, and you don't really see the street team things anymore where, you know, lampposts would be covered up
right.
with posters. I mean, they would really hit the streets and people wake up the next morning and just like, yeah, who's this? And looking around and it would cause a buzz and hype. Now it's all about your numbers on Instagram, this, that, and the third, which is cool. But I think actually a combination of both would really is what's supposed to be done, and that's what I'm in the process of doing.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. And I asked that. See, you see how you said I'm in that process of doing that? You know, you find yourself getting a little too comfortable in the sense where, hold up, I come from an era where I hit the pavement. You dig what I'm saying? I did a slew of different things, and not to look at the younger folk and say, yo, man, you don't know what this is about. But at the end of the day, you have left that alone to say, you know what? This is easy access, but now the combination of two is a must.
Definitely.
So, you know, I ask that once again just to see where you stand with that. As far as, I was reading also, man, that so I heard you lyrically, you know what I mean, freestyle-wise. Tell us about this Guinness Book, man, situation.
Okay, this was about a year after TriBoro formed.
Right.
Now, we were in the studio religiously every week, and the funny thing about it, what we were doing, which actually, where I gained some of the more of the ability of doing, shout out to Fresh Air out of Triboro, is because while we would record, we would always take time out to play beats and just freestyle. Not no cameras, nothing, just we
was
just honed our skills.
Was it about exercise? You know how we exercise. Right.
Totally lyrical exercise.
Right.
You know, and that's what we would do. We would just be on it like that. And Aloos came one day on one of our sessions and said, yo, they're having a trial for something to break the Guinness World Record in Harlem at the Magic Johnson Theater. So we went down there and they had these auditions for something called a rap-a-thon where you had to rhyme continuously for 24 hours straight. No cursing involved or anything like that. And by doing that, we would break the world record. Now they had 10 teams of 10, which was 100 people in all. And it was sponsored by TNT, Converse, Hot 97.
Right.
Huge event. The winner went to Summer Jam to perform and everything, and the best team. Now, remember, you see, out of the 10 teams of 100, we did the 24-hour thing. We were up there for hours and hours. My team actually did win. And shout out to Fresh Air, who was on that Hot 97 stage with the battle, you know.
Right.
We actually did win, and then ended up the next year doing a commercial for Obama for his first presidency on BET, you know, for that first run. And it was just a great experience because now we ended up breaking our own record year after year, five times after that. So 24, 25, 26, 27, 28,
Rap-a-thon 5.
Right. And that pretty close closed the chapter of us putting, you know, that chapter of us breaking the record five times in a row, you know, with the help of a lot of MCs involved with the hip-hop culture center.
Right. Which at the end of the day was monumental.
I mean, all right, the first Rap-a-thon, Kool Herc set the cipher off.
Right.
Kool Herc. So, who else better, but who worked to set off the cypher to break the world record in a cypher? You know what I mean? And within that whole Hip Hop Culture Center, doing shows, a variety show, having Dougie Fresh beatboxing, we rhyming, you know, all these things, opening up, performing with the Cold Crush. So basically, and this is where I feel like hip hop has kind of lost its step as far as we're not educating or the new era is not educated in the past. And in basketball, rookies know about Earl the Pearl, they know about Frazier, they know about Abdul-Jabbar way before their time because they studied the game that much,
But now that you go into that, Sean, how do you, right? See, now that's a war. Because now, individuals that know the art, right, and know the essence of it, still can possibly get caught up in the web because now they're in the now, and they want to win. So some would say, I'm going to compromise, right, what I stood for,
and relinquish ties with that to be down with this, right? How do you deal with that?
Well,
and your sound.
Yeah, see, that actually was a process I had to go under, you know what
right.
I mean? And TriBoro, we are pure hip-hop. So as far as that was concerned, we were known to be a pure hip-hop group, so that never changed. That's what we were. A lot of people that know that may not know my past, and as I branched off into doing some more solo things, about 2 years ago, actually, when I started thinking the idea of doing some stuff, we did a mixtape, but I said, let me start doing some songs. And I got some production, actually, randomly.
Right.
And it was high, but it was kind of bouncy and stuff. And I was like, you know, it's not really my thing, but
right.
I'm going to do it, whatever. People liked the song, but inside I didn't feel comfortable.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Mm.
And I got to go with my gut. My thing is, you know what, I can flow on that. And if I did appearances, I could do that all day. But that's not what's in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did was I started comprising music. I met up with a producer named Mousetrap out of Texas, originally from New York. And he just sent me fire. And we just started making something, and it's like I had a vision of a project. I said, you know what, it's time to make a classic album. And what I mean by that is look at my ancestors in hip-hop, The Adventures of Slick Rick, Redman's
right.
first album, Nas' first album, Raekwon's album, what it had, the diversity in each track, not just one wave of something for a whole bunch of songs, and then you may switch it up, you know.
Right.
You gotta have an experience in the music. That's what makes it classic, like giving them diversity. So I started, you know, recording these records and filling out what it would be to be a blueprint of a classic album.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually what I'm in the process of now, which
mm-hmm.
is, you know, there's no time limit on when it's done. I'm just recording right
no,
now.
No, right, which is a good thing. And I say that because now, once again, as we rewind that, you fought that war for a little while. You dig what I'm saying? Listen, let me try my hand at that. You know,
mm-hmm.
let me try my hand at that beat. You dig what I'm saying? I'll throw it out there so that the possibility of the younger crowd or our age bracket, our era might say, you know what, damn, you know, Sean Conn do got a little diversity,
mm-hmm.
but that war internally is a hard gamble right there.
Mm-hmm.
You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So now you say to yourself, hold up, nah, let's revert back to the past.
Yeah.
You gave a layout of individuals that gave your album that was diverse.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't it be done now? You dig what I'm saying?
Definitely.
So now, what you have a single out right now.
Yeah, I actually have a couple where what I wanted to do was just give that diversity. So the first single that I released for this project was called Silver Lining.
Right, this is one, right.
Yeah, so Silver Lining was a record that was actually a hip-hop statement. It wasn't meant to be a certain kind of single. It wasn't meant to be a club record, but more of a statement and where I stand in hip-hop in my perspective. So that's kind of what it is behind every dark cloud is the Silver Lining,
mm-hmm.
you know? So I did that record knowing that was just a message, you know what I mean? That wasn't the real kick. So after that, back to back, what I did was I recorded a song called The Highlight, which we'll get into that, but I'm going to say the Golden Mic.
Okay, okay.
Done, and also recorded a song called The Golden Mic. And those are the three singles that I'm kind of circulating, you know, while the project is being worked on. The Golden Mic is really Sean Conn, hip-hop secret agent. It's like the persona of who I am for hip-hop, the things that I've seen in the past that a lot of people wouldn't even believe that I was around
right.
for
right.
and actually witnessed it with my own eyes. And so it's like I'm a secret agent because like you wouldn't believe it. So it's like it was a mission.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, that's what I had to do. And Sean Conn is synonymous with Sean Connery,
after
the original James Bond.
Right, right, right.
You know what I mean? So, but within that, it's just the fact of putting this project together and as I'm doing it with those three records, it's just three different feels. The Highlight has Vin Keaton featured on it. That song right now is playing across the country over 1,000 times a week. It's now in the top Billboard 200.
Okay,
you
okay.
Know,
talk that talk.
Yeah, it just hit 180 on the top Billboard 200. And on the independent chart, it's actually number 58 on their 200 chart. So, it's only been moving like that for about a month or so, you know, but it's grown.
So here's the thing. Now, see, this is what I like. As an indie artist, right? I've come across a lot of artists that will throw a song out, SoundCloud it, and that's just that. You giving me Billboard, so you understand the art of now
mm-hmm.
putting the song out and processing it now, making it your, right? So now we deal with, you know, the sound scale. We deal with a slew of different things, man.
Definitely.
That comes with someone that's seasoned. Now, the album, let's fast forward, album-wise, right? Let's just say it comes out 4 months from now.
Mm-hmm.
How are you looking to distribute it?
Well, you know, I started my own company, Vigga Entertainment, mm-hmm. which is very intelligent, getting goals accomplished. That's mm-hmm. what Vigga stands for. And with that, I'm in control creatively. I make all the business decisions.
Mm-hmm.
I manage myself. I do everything where the vision that I have is coming across exactly how I see it. Because mm-hmm. sometimes when you bring other people into it, they can't help, but then they have a vision and they have something they think you should do. And if you know in your heart something's right, man, go with your gut feeling.
Right.
You know what I mean? A lot of people fail by not doing that. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? So I'm sticking to my guns. And what I do know is the diversity of this project will cross over any age group from young to old. Mm-hmm. I have my daughter who is 9 years old. She's on the album
mm-hmm.
and she made the chorus.
Mm-hmm.
But that chorus is what, trust me, by the summertime, all the kids are going to be dancing mm-hmm. to that. I know that because it comes. She's from that era.
Right, right.
That's not me. My hook would have been a little more complicated. She made it very simple and catchy. You
but,
know what I mean?
But sometimes you have to fall back to understand that, you know, it's about simplicity at times.
Yo, and that's what that record is because I studied that James Brown, a lot of his records, he would just play the music in front of his kids and they would just yell out stuff and then he would make those into right. songs. And I thought about that, so I played this beat that my friend sent me and it was a popping beat, definitely. And I just said, you know what? I need something simple. So I played it for my daughter because she dances, she sings, she does all types of stuff. I said, make a chorus for this. Like, what do you think a hook would be like this? 30 seconds later, and I recorded it and we went to the studio and did that. I said, that's it right there.
Now listening to this, right? Give me, I want you to give me three artists from, you know, that golden era,
mm-hmm.
and three up and coming artists that, if not inspire you lyrically, but inspire you in a format of hustling hard,
mm-hmm.
Promoting themselves mm-hmm. and everything else. Give me three from then and three from now.
Well, three from then, definitely Redman, mm-hmm. Nas, and if you want to really start from the essence of that, or that whole what started that, like, was Rakim, I would say.
Okay.
You know, so inspired wise, between Nas and Rakim, Nas is like the newer version of him, mm. so to speak.
And he still got longevity.
Oh, yeah, longevity, you know, which is the difference. And you know, same thing with Jay or people like that. And, you know, that's because they stay with the trends of what's going on because they stay relevant by making things, creating, always creating. As far as three now, inspired in a way where I look at an artist like Drake. I don't care what people have all types of things to say.
You said Drake?
Drake.
Okay, definitely. Yeah.
And what I say by that is, he is very versatile.
Mm-hmm.
He can be lyrical, but he understands his pocket. He understands where his fan base, and he goes right and caters to them.
Mm-hmm.
And he has a huge fan base on that. There's nothing wrong with that. He's a smart businessman by doing that.
Because mm-hmm.
he can be lyrical, no, but right. he knows his pocket.
Right.
He's saying he does that. You know, that impresses me. Artists that I think people sleep on, who lyrically, because, you know, there's a couple of lyrical people here and there, but I give Big Sean credit, man, because I think that he's slept on and underrated, you know, maybe because, I don't know, people think you have to be a tough guy persona, you know, he doesn't right. seem like a tough guy, nothing like that, he's a cool person, but musically, you know what I'm saying, he's creative and he's talented, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? So, and not for nothing, like J. Cole, of mm. course, I like because lyrically, he's an MC and he can fit right in the pocket of Golden
uh-huh.
mm-hmm. That fits and that still transcends into today because big up to all the artists that are still doing their thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just because they're not in the mainstream eye doesn't mean they're not still killing it and doing shows and, you know, whatever.
Great layout. Regarding your album, right, we're going to get into the album.
Mm-hmm.
Will it be, I always throw this out there, will it be a compilation or is it Sean Conn?
Well,
and I say compilation because sometimes
oh, yeah,
people
I know.
Feel mm-hmm. to have a creative and a full album, right? They have to have the individual that's popping now, mm-hmm. then, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they outshine the artist.
Yeah.
Any features?
There are some features, and you know, only because the way at first, it was more of a vision I had, and I saw what an album should be like in my mind, at least from my perspective. And that was the man with the golden mic. But then I said, okay, I'm on a mission. I'm a secret agent in hip-hop, right? So I gotta do some missions, okay? So one, definitely bring the TriBoro back together.
Right.
Operation TriBoro. I actually just recorded that a couple of weeks ago for that project. That's one. A lot of it is myself. Also, shout out to Milo Raines, mm-hmm. who is part of family as well.
Mm-hmm.
We were on a mission. We did a mission for the album. And of course, I have a lot of fans overseas in Canada and other places.
Mm.
Shout out to Charlie Fetter from Winnipeg's Most. Rest in peace to Brooklyn. you know, they're very dominant out there in the Winnipeg, Canada, mm-hmm. and he's a cold stone lyricist, you know what I mean? So give him credit. I had to put him on the project, you know. And also a good friend of mine from Queens who was out there, homeboy Sandman.
Oh, Sandman.
He's definitely touring around the globe right now, doing his thing heavy.
Yeah, Sandman. You know, he's a good teacher.
Yeah, he's very dope, right? You know, very dope. And you know, we got a song, you know, Quest, we got a nice song, we're going a little quest, you know, it's very creative. You know, that's the diversity.
I love the theme though. I love this. I love that, man. That's, I love the concept.
Oh yeah, I'm going to a lot of different places because, like I said, to make a classic album, you have to give people an adventure. You got to take them somewhere. It's not just skip to the hottest song. This is something you play straight through.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And also, of course, Vin Keaton, which our song is Billboard charting right now. You know, he just gave it the soulful sounds. And shout out to Maxwell for bigging him up.
Right.
On social media and telling people about him, so he's something special as well. So it was definitely a dope thing for us to do that project. And you know, I may have another feature. But the one thing that I will do, and it's not done until me and Nas do a song together.
And you will make it happen.
Oh no, there's still, I'm already, that's in the process, you know. And if it's me, Nas, and Jada on the same record, cool, I can go with that. But besides that, the rest of it is Sean Conn. You know, I'm just giving you a piece of what I am as far as, this is the second chapter of my career, mm-hmm. as far as from being a solo artist, being in a group, and now branching back off into the solo. And you know, TriBoro is like Wu-Tang, it's
right,
forever.
Right, right, right.
But you know, just showing you who Sean Conn is at this point.
You know, business-wise, you seem like you have a strong head on your shoulders. Definitely have a universal appeal. Is there any other business ventures that you would like to delve into or currently involved in?
Well, there's a few that I'm into. Vigga Entertainment is an entertainment company,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is multimedia. You know, we're looking into everything from sports mm-hmm. to film. You know, I'm actually in a film with Vin Keaton, who is the main actor of the film. Mm-hmm. That's how I actually met him. You know what I mean? So things like that. Once I get myself in position, because what I'm doing right now is I'm planting the seed with this. I'm using myself as, so to speak, the guinea pig, but I know the plan is already accurate, you know what I mean?
Of
so
course.
it's not like a fail, you know, it's already set in place. The success of what I'm doing will put me in the position to help other artists that I know personally, or I may not know, but I believe in what they're doing.
Okay.
And I can help them because I've taught myself everything I need to know to do everything by myself. Not saying that I am doing everything by myself.
This I get it. Right.
Me along
right.
The
of course. Cool.
And you know, Jomar, Dino, Mousetrap, of course, production wise. But I wanted to do that because in this game, and as much as I've seen, a lot of people will sell you dreams. There are people that will let you down. You know, there are people that will lie to you. But you never do that to yourself. You won't let yourself down. You won't lie to yourself. And you're not going to let yourself, you know, you're going to know what you're doing for yourself.
Well, but it goes back to the trials and tribulations of what you went through and your path to get to this point. You dig what I'm saying? Like you said, not that I'm that self-contained, but in the same token, you know, there's some things that I just need to accomplish on my own. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
Because I gave part of me, or basically all of me throughout, you know, at times throughout my career, and it didn't fare well at times, you dig? So that's what you, anything else?
Well, definitely.
Talk to us, and we close.
What we're gonna do is, right now, of course, the highlight is playing all over the country. We're pushing that record hard. You know, that's gonna get where it has to go.
Video wise,
now the Golden Mic, shout out to that video, just hit over 100,000 views in under 2 months. We're about 2 months in now. Also, get ready to look at that for BT, MTV, Fuse, every network, of course. Robbie Williams is the first to play it, as it's supposed to be. And the highlight, we're gonna go somewhere like Fantasy Island. You know what I'm saying? We're gonna take it to a tropical island, because that song needs that look. You know what I mean? And it's gonna be something beautiful, so look out for that. And the man with the golden mic, of course, is the project. And like I said, man, I promise y'all, classic album. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that from being a student of the game and knowing the blueprint of what is the ability to do it. You know what I mean? And also the business savvy to make it happen, to get to the people. You know what I mean?
So, I mean, you gave us a lot, man. Give me a few balls, man, in closing, man.
Yo, you say you the Don, well I'm the Don Tester. Niggas more like Don Kings and Uncle Festers. What's the logic? These rappers spitting garbage, no knowledge. They better respect the real Vigga and pay homage. I'm putting plans in motion to fulfill the dream. My regime heavy and built like a construction team. Calling me love hip hop, but I lust the cream, bust the scene. Pull up in the Benz looking mustard green. Blowing steam, eye the tiger. I'm a chosen being, hit him with the bing, had that nigga do the shoulder lean. And I'm sick of rappers rolling in the roller king, saying what you done, where you been, you ain't sold a thing. What's the scan on it? Scam on it, you done did a bullshit record and put your mans on it. And hoes can't get enough, got that act right. They say they get addicted to the dick like a crack pipe. I'm just giving the game something that was needed. Hoping you corny rappers all get deleted. A monster on the track, cocksucker, beat it. Before you get Meek Mills, that mean defeated. Mm. Light-skinned niggas win the fight. I'm Frankenstein, had to bring the dead back to life. Tension so thick, you can cut it with a knife. It's Vigga Entertainment, motherfucker, get it right.
Nice, nice. This is what we do, man.
Oh, nah, this is all day, and you know, man, that the written freestyles. And just to let y'all know, man, when I do interviews, I'm gonna be freestyling. That's an art form that a lot of people, I'm talking about off the top,
right?
I was, you know, a little bogged, but when I'm on them stages and you see me around and the beats is playing, I'm gonna be rhyming better than some of your favorite rappers off the top of the dome. I promise that.
Oh man, I appreciate you, man. Give me some of your social networks.
Okay, no doubt. Everything to find the Hip Hop Secret Agent is Sean Conn 00. So that's SEANCONN 20s. That's the website, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and the artist, man. Keep that all in one, man, so people can find you. It's a lot easier, you know what I mean?
The art of being independent. I so love it, man. I'm going to follow this blueprint as well. We appreciate you, Terrell Blair, HLM Media. It's the letter with sounds. Levels management.